Okay, this class is Mr. Stein. Mr. Stein, this is class 824. Say hi.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Stein, why don't you come up and make yourself comfortable? And we're going to just give you an idea why Mr. Stein is here today. Mr. Stein was born in 1939. So he lived through all the years of our current unit. And he will have a unique perspective. He also speaks German, Austrian, and Hungarian, and English. Can I show them where you were born, Mr. Stein?
Absolutely.
Okay. Everybody got Mr. Stein already? Can I take this down? Because I know you've already written it. Right, Rachel? Several times by now? So this is the city of Banat. This is the city of Mr. Stein's birth. Although I suspect right now he's looking at it going, that's a lot better than I expected it to look. Is that correct?
Well, what happens is we were farmers. We were outside the city. Okay, this is the main, or I should say, it's the regional headquarters of a region of Banat. If you could get that, here we go. Said, I was born here in Banat. But let me explain the history of what happened. Before World War I, Europe was basically five major powers. It was the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which was not only Austria, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Galicia, portion of Poland, Romania, all the Balkan states, Serbia, Bosnia, Herzegovina, Croatia. The north of Italy was Austrian. All the regions, all the way down to the Adriatic Sea. It was a kingdom. There was Austria, then there was the German states, there was France, England, and Spain.
Do you guys want me to bring up the old map, or do you guys have a decent enough visual?
So what happened is, after the First World War was settled, all these major powers broke apart. Austria-Hungarian Empire, which was 10 states and approximately 14 different languages, all people lived together, broke apart. And all of a sudden, Austria itself became a little state, which is about half the size of New Jersey and only has about 8 million people. Mm. So, and then became Hungary, then Yugoslavia became a state. And between 1919, when the war ended, and 1939, 20 years, the economy in Europe, just like the United States when you had depression, became very bad. When things go bad, dictators arise. And all of a sudden you had Germany, Hitler, you had Stalin in Russia, you had Tito in Yugoslavia, you had Franco in Spain. And when you have dictators, you have power struggles. So the war broke out in 1939 when I was born. We lived on a farm. My family was farmers. We were ethnic Germans. How did ethnic Germans wind up in Hungary and in what today is basically used to be Yugoslavia? What happened in 1705, the Austrian army defeated the Turks again. They were defeated in 1683 outside Vienna.
That you're going to study next year in global, or more likely in 10th grade.
Okay. So we were, and the Ottoman Empire was pushed out. And how do you sell? So you offer free land, just like, you know, we did in the United States, free land, if you go and settle in those regions where at one time the Ottomans were. Now it's interesting to know that the Hungarians are a totally different language. They don't relate to any language. They're basically a Mongolian language. Hungarian is a totally different So here we are. We are, my family's ethnic German. We run a farm. We raise pigs. We have vineyards. And German army came in. Well, actually, they annexed Austria in 1938.
You guys remember the annexation of Austria?
Yes.
Annexed in 1938. Then they came in to Hungary, Romania, because they went in there because Romania had oil, the second largest oil producer in Europe. And then they started invading in the Balkans. The reverse happened, the war changed, the Russians came in, and with the Russians, they designated the partisans of Yugoslavia, who for us was totally, totally fatal. Ethnic cleansing happened. The Germans were, ethnic Germans were separated, which we were part of the group.
Excuse the interruption, please. Will Dawson Lockhart, Daniel Titian, and Justin Molina from Class 803 report to Ms. Mazrum? Thank you.
Almost.
So separated. Ethnic Germans were separated. Hungarians were separated. The Slovaks were separated. The Romanians were separated. We wound in a concentration camp. Some people died.
Can I show them the pictures right now?
Yes.
This is the concentration camp where his family was taken to. It's called Rudolfstadt, which is, this is the place where they lived, and this is how far it was. It was literally, they built a camp on their doorstep, and there you see the bodies and the prisoners.
Basically, camp was not what he called the death camp in a sense. The death camp was basically because you starved to death. As a side note, my first wife, she passed away. She is Elizabeth, my daughter, child. I had a brother who starved to death at age 7. Then what happened, Red Cross stepped in, and they finally realized that they couldn't kill it.
Couldn't feed.
And couldn't kill and feed the people, so they shipped us. First to Hungary, we wound up in prison in Budapest, and of course they didn't have any food. Everybody was starving, and then they shipped us to Austria. Austria, it was a German-speaking nation, basically accepted us. And we wound up in 1945 in Vienna. And we have history in Vienna because my grandfather in the First World War served in Vienna in the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. He was in the army. Actually, as a side note, he was a prisoner of war in Russia for about 4 years, in 1915 to 1919. As we wound up in Vienna, everything was basically destroyed. We had no school, the schools were bombed out. Second, in the winter time, we had no coal. Sometimes we sat in classrooms with coats on, hats on, gloves on, if we had gloves. But the worst part was no food. There wasn't a cat or dog alive in Vienna for about 4 or 5 years. We were lucky. We lived in an old building, in a classroom, maybe a little bit bigger than this, with 30 people.
How many of you are in the room right now?
32.
This is now how you live. Not where you sit for 40 minutes. This is where you live and sleep and held all your stuff, and you all share one little bathroom.
Well, the bathroom was outside.
Okay, well, that's something.
It was the old-fashioned one, gravity. What happened? How do you have privacy? you know, strings across here, just like you have it here, hang blankets, and this was your cubicle, and that basically was it. We were lucky, my family. It was my grandfather, my grandmother, actually was 2 years longer. She was in a concentration camp where only they took the old females, and I mean old females, 50 and over. She came 2 years later to Vienna. But it was my grandfather, my mother, my sister, and I.
Can I just highlight it?
Distances, you have to remember the distances. Here's Budapest, here's Vienna. You know how small Vienna is now? Vienna used to be, Austria-Hungarian Empire used to go all the way up here. All about this. Galicia, Poland, Czechoslovakia. That was the Austrian-Hungarian Empire at one time. And, you know, that's why so many languages. And as you can see, you probably know this before you were born. In the 1990s, they had another ethnic cleansing where it was a major war where the United States was involved with Europe. Because basically it comes down to a lot of this language and religion. The Serbs are Orthodox, the Croatians are Catholic, the Bosnians are Muslims, Albanians are Muslims, Hungarians are Catholic. Catholic, Jewish, non-Jewish. In Vienna, my grandfather did business there. We had a population of every mix, because what happened was the headquarters of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. You had about 14 different languages. You could, just like the European zone now, you could come from Russia, you come to Vienna, and you didn't have to become basically a citizen at all. Matter of fact, Lenin, who started the revolution, lived in
Zurich,
in Vienna for about 2 years. Lived in Zurich for 2 years. Interesting thing was that Hitler, in 1908, lived in the same street as Lenin did in Vienna, which is a little note which people tell you when you travel to Vienna. We had, in our classroom, we had between 40 and 45 students in a class, and we got good education. It was a different system than you had.
Oh, do tell them about this, please. I'd really like them to know this.
You were told what to do. No smart aleck answers. You didn't do any homework. First you got beaten up by the teacher, and then you were sent home, and you got beaten up by your parents.
We would like to do a demonstration of this for the volunteers.
And there was no gift. You studied, that was your assignment. You passed your courses. Heaven forbid you failed. It was strict. But when you are in a situation where you don't have much freedom and you're basically starving, and you go to class at 7:30, come home at 3:30, 6 days a week, not 5 days a week, okay, you learn. We were lucky we were in the American zone. Vienna, when the Americans came in and the Russians came in, they divided Austria into four zones, and Vienna was divided into four zones. And Americans, Russian, French, and English. We were lucky we were in a district which was American. And the reason I mentioned it to you, we were starving. We did get some aid packages from the Red Cross and helped us survive, but my family survived because the Americans were stationed in a school, and as they were dumping out the garbage at breakfast, lunch, and dinner, we young kids at age 6 and 7 jumped into those pits, grabbed whatever was there, didn't care if somebody had eaten it or bit on it or bone, steak, whatever was there, rushed it home. And sometimes we fight because, you know, it's limited. Took it home to my grandmother, she cleaned it, and this is how we survived. And I especially was lucky because I was a cute kid, this black sergeant, first time I saw a black person, which was another experience, sort of waved to me, and of course I was afraid of him. And as he came closer to me, I would start running. So it took a while before I sort of trusted him. And I got care package for me. I brought it home, and my grandmother got mad as hell. She thought I stole it because it was neatly wrapped. You know, it was nice food in there, it wasn't dirty from the garbage. And I had to get my grandmother to come with me. So the sergeant would say, yes, it's okay. Language difficulty and all that, but finally. So in 1946-47, things were bad. Tell you a little story. You know, Christmas. My grandchildren are Jewish. I'm Catholic. I have three daughters who are married to different religions, so we believe in everything. My second wife, I was very fortunate to find a second wife, wonderful second wife, who's Jewish. She has two children. So we have seven grandchildren, and they all are different religions. But we all celebrate Christmas. Of course, we celebrate Hanukkah too, so we get both celebrated. But I will tell you, and I hope this stays with you. Do you know what a blood orange is? I'm sure you've seen it. Very good blood orange.
I'll find you one.
In 1947, for Christmas, my sister and I got blood orange. It was the best present I ever got. My grandmother peeled it, and she gave us each two sections. And it was the best thing I've ever eaten. And she said, now let's put this away so that tomorrow we have another section, and tomorrow we have another section, and for 4 days we ate one orange. It's the biggest memory, best present, except my children I ever had. How about that? There it is. You know, it's interesting. When I talk to people like you, and I do it very rarely. Matter of fact, I have not told my grandchildren a lot of things. It's Vienna Opera. Spend many days there, many hours there. And when you talk to, I grew up in Vienna, I studied in Vienna, and then in 1956, I was 17 years old, when you grow up, you should go there. It's absolutely magnificent.
I've been there.
Yes, my children, as a matter of fact, I have a promise. This year, I'm taking my two grandchildren, Katie and Emily, and with my wife, we're going to Vienna in the Thanksgiving weekend. Hopefully, I can get them off from school.
We're going anyway.
Okay. I graduate. In 1956, my grandfather said to me, there's no future here. In my class of 35 in high school, 25 left Vienna, just like I did. Two went to the United States, including me. Germany, Holland, England, Spain, and Australia, because there was more opportunity. I came to the United States, and I wound up in Philadelphia.
That's not what I want.
In 56. What was so interesting is my professor, Louis Kahn, the best person I ever met in my life, he designed this. He was a famous architect worldwide.
What was Philadelphia like in 1956 for you?
56 was very interesting, and 56, Philadelphia was very, I'm not going to say ruling aspect, a lot of immigrants. We found the intersection called Germantown, but it was mostly Ukrainian. They had their own markets. They were traders on the street. There were little markets on the street. People were roaming around in cars selling vegetables, various things. They had a lot of social clubs. You had Germans, Ukrainians. You had Hungarians. You had Irish. You had Polish. They were roughly about 22 separate clubs where the people could meet, make contacts, and meet socially, especially on the weekends. And each one of those clubs had soccer. And I happened to be a very good soccer player. And somebody saw me play on a team. The first thing I did when I came to the United States, I worked in a factory. Because, you know, I wasn't acquainted yet. I worked in a factory. Yes?
What was your favorite club, like soccer?
Soccer, Rapid Vienna. That's where I came from.
He's coming from Vienna, what a shock.
Okay, but I will tell you, I'll come to that. What happened is I got a job the next day in a factory, making yarn, 8 hours a day, and then within a week I was working 16 hours a day, 6 days a week. And on Sunday, I played soccer for one of the social clubs. And I worked for 2 years to make money because I figured I needed money to go to school. So I'm playing soccer, and somebody sees me and recommends me to somebody who knows somebody, make a long story short, wound up with the soccer coach at the University of Pennsylvania. And I wound up at the University of Pennsylvania, Ivy School, full scholarship for 6 years. I became an architect. And that's why Louis Kahn. Oh, that's the Ukrainian national team. This is Louis Kahn. Oh my God, I will tell you. The other thing is, this is La Jolla in California. It's a Salk Institute. He invented the Salk for polio vaccine. Magnificent structure. Like a church. So I graduate in 1965. Sorry. Met my first wife here. She came from the same region in Europe. Just happened that she belonged to another social club and playing soccer and thing. I met her there. On a note, this my wife's brother. They were both in a concentration camp. Starved to death at age 8. And my wife, who is Elizabeth's mother, had deformed feet, frozen, lost toes, and had a certain walk because you couldn't put pressure because you didn't have all the those on your feet. And yet, you go back, and I went back a couple of times to see my grandparents. They didn't want to come. They thought America is for young people. And they were right. It was a great opportunity. All my friends who left Vienna to some degree succeeded. And I went back to see my grandparents. My grandfather died in 1970, and now a little interesting story, because my grandmother was 82 years old. I said, I'm not leaving the choice. You're coming with me. You're coming back to the United States. Now, think about it. gentleman born in 1884. First time she saw a railroad was in 1912. Okay? First time she saw a car was probably 1920. And she comes to the United States in 1972-73. She lived with us. Matter of fact, Elizabeth was just a small baby. And she adjusted, and something strange happened. She had an accident, she fell down our stairs. We had a two-story house. And she fell down the stairs because she was always moving. She was teaching my wife how to cook, or cook better, I should say. She was a wonderful, wonderful cook. So she fell and she broke her head. Well, our hospital, we lived in Huntington Valley, had a hospital called Holy Redeemer, which is another unique story. The Holy Redeemer is a Catholic hospital run by nuns. Where did those nuns come from? Germany. Hitler invaded Sudetenland and closed the cloister. There were two businessmen in Philadelphia whose father came from Germany. They had a major, major leather factory. Had a sister who was a nun. Make a long story short, 55 nuns were brought over in 1935, and those two businessmen built them a small hospital in close to Center City to take care of people. And as they grew and they became famous for their treatments and the service, the two businessmen decided to build them a bigger hospital in the suburbs. And this is where my grandmother wound up. So obviously she's there for 3 weeks, broken hip. She's 84 years old, 85. She meets Mother Superior, who starts talking German to her, and they start. And as she meets more outpatient treatment, Mother Superior comes to me and says, "Mr. Stein, can I make a recommendation? We would love to have your grandmother at our old hospital, where it's now a retirement home for all the older nuns."
How do you say no to that?
So it was hard to accept. She went there. And it was wonderful because at that time, Elizabeth, she was 3 years old. Now imagine, these are older nuns, they're retired. And on the weekend, I would come with my children, especially a three-year-old, blonde, blue-eyed, whatever, at that time. And the nuns would just fawn over her, and everything, they were waiting. The nuns were waiting at the door on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. I had to be punctual for the children to arrive. The other thing happened, and it was the best thing my grandmother happened, is she was a wonderful cook. And she was not afraid to tell you if your food didn't measure up to her standards. And she told Mother Superior, and my grandmother wound up running the kitchen till she died at 92 years old. So, when I tell you, my family has been very lucky to wind up here. But what happens is, as things happen, history repeats itself. What happened right now in Syria and Iraq, the ethnic cleansing, people get killed. My great-grandfather was rounded up with 40 other older people. My great-grandfather was 92 years old, had to dig his own trench and got a bullet in his back of his head. Ethnic cleansing. It's happening today. It happened in the First War, not in the First War, in the Second War.
After the First War, it also happened.
Yes, correct. Yeah, in Armenia. Genocide. And then it happened again in the 90s with the Serbs and the Croatia. I don't know if you've studied
it. Guys, you remember me talking about the Kosovar Albanians at all? Not really? we'll have to talk more about it.
It was... You know, the things which horror to it. For instance, the side story is my oldest daughter has been living in Europe since she graduated from college. And the reason she lived in Europe, I could afford to send her and travel and all that, and she studied over there. And she was offered a job by Mercedes-Benz in Stuttgart, Germany, at age 22. Okay? So, of course, I let her go. My wife at that time was very mad at me for letting her go there. But she had a wonderful time. She had two sets of grandparents who were giving her money. The father and mother gave her money. She lived the life of a wonderful princess. But the reason I'm telling you this story is to relate to the war in Serbia in the 1992-95. She and a friend, three friends, went to vacation to a little island in Greece. She was a deprived child. And on the way back, they came by train. They stopped in Sarajevo, which is the capital of. And their experience was twofold. One, they went to restaurants. The menu was long, but there was only one thing available, chicken feet. The second thing is, in the stores, they saw beautiful wear, and when they wanted to buy it, they didn't have it. And lights were shut off at 6 o'clock at night because they didn't have the money, even for hospitals. Just think about it. And the reason for it is they had the Olympics in Sarajevo, the Winter Olympics in Sarajevo, spent so much money on the Olympics, and then because of the war, they were totally broke. And today it still shows, if you go to Sarajevo, it's not rebuilt yet, and it's 20 years later. So, when because of different nations all together.
That's more like it, okay.
93. Yep. They were just killing each other, which is unbelievable. And then, of course, they did the ethnic cleansing. And as you probably read in the newspaper now, they still have civil trials in Holland.
They're digging up
bodies.
Corpses.
Digging up bodies now. That's basically an outline of what I have. If anybody has questions, please.
You want to take a little break?
No, I'm fine.
Do you guys need a break? Okay, so what we're going to do is Mr. Stein will be calling his own students, not me, unless I, you know, want to spread it around. Try and give everybody an opportunity to ask or answer a question. Is there anything that you should not ask you about? Okay, Alan, you have your hand up first.
Before, are you still in touch with your friend that was looking here in America?
Yes. Yes. Actually, he retired. He is your classmate of mine. He lives in Chicago. After my first wife passed away, I went to a class reunion in Vienna in 2001. And out of the 35 people, about 22 showed up. Interesting how my class spread. One of them was in the foreign service in Austria, in the station in Japan, met the daughter of the Sri Lankan ambassador and married her, and he lives in Sri Lanka today. The other one, my wife met, we had a reunion of friends, one of my oldest friends. So we go back since kindergarten. He invited us to his birthday celebration, 65, 70, I believe. piano, and here was another classmate who was ambassador, Austrian ambassador in Australia, and he met the ambassador, female ambassador, from Madagascar, which is the Indian Ocean, I'm sure you know that. And they basically, they got married. So here you have one person from Vienna and one person from Madagascar, which is an independent nation. Interesting how we all spread our wings, so to speak. We have another friend who is married to a Dutch girl, lives in Holland. The daughter of a very good friend of mine married an English guy. She lives in Manchester.
You know she's free to leave Manchester, right?
Yes. Manchester is a very industrial town. But you see, pictures like this, the countryside of Banat, I have pictures, you know, private pictures, but this is very familiar to me. Horses, wagons, beautiful countryside. It was the food basket of Europe, basically. This is basically a very, no tractors, no. We mostly raised pigs, wheat, and we had vineyards.
Pardon?
We had wonderful horses. As a matter of fact, my father had a purebred Arabian, which he used at stud services, and cows. When you're a farmer, you know, we had a great life because we weren't hungry, and then all of a sudden everything happens to you, and relatives are killed, and you're uprooted, and you're told because you speak a certain language and have a certain religion, you're not wanted anymore. And what's sad is I'm getting older, and I've gotten older, much older. This happens again and again and again. You know, very few people talk about Rwanda. Well, Rwanda, in the last 10 years, 6 million people have been killed. But it doesn't make the headlines. Syria now, when you look at the pictures, I start to shake. Because I only had experience a few months with bombs. But when you see cities like this, this is what Vienna looked like in 1945, 1946. And now it is 2015. Okay?
So we have two gentlemen with their hands up, three gentlemen. Ashmoor, you gotta get the door ahead of you.
Do you see any connection between World War II and the wars coming after it? Like, is there any commonalities or any pattern that you see?
It's a very good question. Well, certain things were not resolved in the Second World War, and especially in the Middle East. What happened is, as you know, the French controlled Lebanon, the British controlled Palestine, Israel, Iraq, Jordan, and they did something, again, illogical. They didn't recognize the various sections. And today we see the result. We have the Sunnis and the Shiites, who have never gotten along together for the last, 2,000 years, or less than that. So they tried to combine it in one state, and only a dictator could hold them together. And what happened to Saddam Hussein, you know, held them together by brutal force. As soon as you start democracy, it falls apart. Same thing in Syria, same thing in Egypt. Saudi Arabia, eventually, the kingdom will fall because of, again, the internet. People become educated. Iraq, Iran, yes, connection is still there. It has not been resolved.
One?
Yes, sir.
We have one in the back over there.
Did you ever go back to Germany?
To Austria, yes. I traveled quite a bit. I made my children go back because I wanted them to experience. As I told you, my oldest daughter was in Sarajevo and she was trying to buy something and couldn't buy it. On the other hand, my second daughter was traveling all over Europe for 2 summers and she was happened to be in East Berlin. She got still under the communists. The wall came down in 89. She was there in 87. And she traveled, they had magnificent museums over in East Berlin, the old museums, especially the Natural History Museum.
Mm-hmm.
So she finished her day, and all of a sudden she saw a line. And she said, did I miss something? She looked at a map. No. So she followed the line came around the block, the line followed the next block, corner, the line crossed again to the next corner. She said, what's going on? She makes the last turn, in the middle of the block, people are waiting. You know what they're waiting for? The bread store to open at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. To buy a loaf of bread. 1987. Ask your mom and dad how good they have it in 1987. You could buy anything you wanted. I wanted my children to travel, so I have traveled. Matter of fact, my wife and I traveled quite a bit. We just spent last Christmas in Berlin, Dresden. Because you want to learn the history of Dresden. Dresden was a famous city, beautiful Baroque buildings. In 1945, it was firebombed by the British. The war was over, practically over, 2 more weeks. It was basically a strike against human beings. There was no military object.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Derek was saying. You see how it looks like right now, right? It's gorgeous, right? You've probably seen those little white porcelain figurines, right, that were made in Dresden. Very beautiful Dresden dolls were made there. And actually, the great writer Kurt Vonnegut was hiding out in the factory during the bombing. He said the bombing actually made him go insane.
It was totally firebombed. 150,000 people died in one night. So that's the reason you go back. That's the reason I want my children to go back, my grandchildren, because if they become a better person, hopefully it will be affect a better world. We were in Dresden, and they have just rebuilt the communists until 1989, didn't do anything. When the wall came down and became one Germany, they started to rebuild the famous Frauenkirche, which was a famous Protestant church, and it was totally leveled. There you go. Okay? Totally leveled.
All right, there it is there, guys. You see it? That's the exterior. Interior.
Absolutely magnificent. We went to Christmas services, my wife and I.
Took them 20 minutes to do.
They literally took the bombed material and numerically marked it up and refilled the thing and it opened up, I believe, in 2008. And absolutely magnificent. It's a Lutheran church. Just magnificent. And so when you say to me, you go back, yes, you want to go back, because history always should teach us. Unfortunately, sometimes it doesn't happen. As I said to you, things tend to repeat themselves. The good things and the bad. Yes, ma'am.
Before the ethnic cleaning and before all that happened with like your family and being uprooted and everything, did you have difficulty like communicating or like befriending other people, like or other religious?
No, not at all. Give an example. The tolerance was incredible. My grandfather told me that in Vienna he had 275,000 Jews. They were totally integrated. They were married off. Our doctor, who was Jewish, married a Catholic woman, so there's no problem. We're on our farm where we lived. My grandparents spoke Hungarian, they spoke Serbian, and they spoke German, and some Romanian. When I was a little boy, I had spoke some Hungarian, because you know, because some of our servants. In the summertime, when you have a big farm, you have about 50 people helping you out as summer help, you know, because the fields and the animals and the various things. So, no, and so there was, but there was one thing which I learned later on. Intermarriage was not a big thing between the various religions, which is very interesting, except in Vienna, which was a lot more cosmopolitan. Than on the farm. Farms usually are very conservative. You know, they don't travel. You have a farm, you have animals, you don't travel. You don't take vacations, okay? Because who's taking care of your animals? So you become a lot more sedate in your ways. But everybody's, that's what's so frustrating about the two wars. All these people live together. Like in Vienna, you know, 10, 12 languages, they all live together. And they had different religions, different practices, different food. And yet, the war breaks out and all of a sudden you have this ethnic cleansing.
We have Danny, we have Raj.
I just wanted to know how, when you still were in the United States, how did farming help you understand what was going on within the country and like all the starvation?
Very good question.
They're all good questions.
What happened, a lot of the farms, well, one of the things what happened, you had, say you had a farm and you had three children, and two were sons, they went to war and never came back, just like my father. My father didn't come back. My father actually was, I believe he was executed, but after the war, because he was a prisoner for it, okay, in Croatia. Didn't come back. So all of a sudden these farms didn't have any heirs. Nobody had money to buy their things, and the farms became desolate. So that didn't help the supply line. The other thing is, you know, the armies, the Germans came in, took all the pigs, and the Russians came in, and the Serbs came in, they took all the animals. Where do you get the money to start up again? And all. So it became, that's why the war years afterwards, from 1945 to about 1949, were starving years. That's why when the United States, with the Marshall Plan, helped Europe, Germany, Austria, and brought in material supplies, money, to rebuild the country. That's what basically what happened. And when you look at it, when you look at the Austrian farms in the 1950s, which came back, and you look at the Hungarians and all the farms, they were desolate because there was not a capital there to reconstitute all those elements.
You remember when we had all the startup expenses and everything that people incur after the war? Start the ball rolling. There isn't anything. We have Shira in the back as well.
Yes.
As you said before, you yourself wasn't in a concentration camp, but your first wife was. Have she ever?
No, I was too.
Oh. Have you or your first wife seen any German war crimes as doctors performing surgeries or different types of?
No, the concentration camps we were in were not that in that category. They were just rounding us up and holding us prisoners. And there was no experiments. No, no, no. and that this was not the German, this was the Serbian basic concentration camp. The German, the Serbians were the ethnic cleansing, but the Serbians were allied with the Russian army. So they when the Russian army came across, the Serbs became the power, and they did the ethnic cleansing. The Romanians, the ethnic Germans, the ethnic Hungarians, the Slovaks, Croatians. So you know, it wasn't only the German ethnic Germans. It was everybody.
Sheer in the back.
You have a lot of knowledge about what was going on in the time. Was that knowledge coming more from you experiencing everything that was going on, or the educational system that you were provided with?
Both, because I read a lot. Obviously, that's how you learn. But you read both sides. You know, I read, for instance, today, nobody can tell you, I read internet newspapers every day. When you read a story in the Philadelphia Inquirer or the New York Times, sometimes the European papers have a totally different take on it than we do. And you want to know both sides, because you need to understand what the other people are thinking, and that's the key. And that's why, for instance, our politicians should travel. And it's frustrating sometimes when you have very famous politicians who run for president have never been to Europe, or have never been to Asia, or have never been to Russia. But if you don't know, how do you think you will understand what these people are?
What so matters to them?
What matters to them? You know, what might be nice for you might be an insult to them. So those are the kind of things. And yes, I had a wonderful education, but I love history, geography, and at one time I could tell you the birthday and birth year of every composer in Mozart, Beethoven, all those things, because that's what my education, that's what I love to do. And history to me was always in front, and I keep up with it.
Sure, before World War II, there's only so much that a formal education could have prepared you, you know, for something like this. You know, this was not the typical history when they're rounding people up and slaughtering them like cattle.
I had English in Indiana, but my English was a Dublin accent. Our teacher was from Dublin, Ireland. So we had this, like, box called walks, you know, and all that thing. So I was a little intimidated, and I wasn't perfect English. But I will tell you, I was the best speller in my freshman class at Penn. And the reason for it is because I had Latin, and I had Greek. That was mandatory. In my high school, we had to have Latin, we had to have Greek, and you have a choice between French and Spanish.
Latin, Greek, Spanish, English. I can't get you to use spell check.
See my knuckles? Heavens forbid if I did something wrong. I remember my Latin teacher was a Jesuit priest.
Ooh.
He would wrap your knuckles so fast they were bleeding.
Once again, we can do a demonstration in class right now.
No, it was a different system. A different system. It encouraged you, and you learn things. You know, Jesuits were well known for their education system. Matter of fact, I live in Philadelphia, and some of the best private Catholic schools are Jesuit. Yes, sir.
Did the experiences that you had when you came into U.S. affect the way that you thought people understood what was going on in Europe, but they really didn't know about this?
No, I was amazed. I was amazed. still amazed at the lack or depth of understanding of the American public what happened in Europe. Not to point out my wife's example, but when I start dating and I talk about certain things, she had no clue. You know, she heard about the Holocaust, but basically that was basically it. But why did it happen? You know, because that's what you blame somebody. First you blame the communists, and then you blame the socialists, and then you run out of blame, and then you blame the Jews, and then you blame the gypsies. And this is how you get elected. And by that time, you're in such great power, you don't need to get elected anymore, because then you can rule whatever you want to. And you kill somebody you want to. And if you don't agree, you throw them into a concentration camp. You know, the concentration camps happened, it's interesting, is there were Germany, but especially Germany, was really bad. Their depression started in 1925, 26. There were street battles between the Nazis, between the communists, between the socialists. They were beating each other up left and right for about 2 or 3 years. And here comes Hitler with his special...
You're talking about the Weimar Republic?
Yeah.
Okay. He's talking about between the wars, the Weimar, between one and two.
And here comes a guy named Hitler with his troops, stormtroopers, and he straightens out the battles and says to the public, I'm your savior. Look what I've done. I eliminated all the street battles. Okay, I'm going to do this and this. And they followed him blindly. Okay?
So he started just like little things when he doesn't
know how he did very well. He executed people who disagreed with him. And then he started to...
See, they're not making problems anymore.
Yeah. And then he created these camps. And they had a big sign, Arbeit macht frei. Work makes free. Okay? So the first ones in there were gypsies, communists, and socialists. Okay? Arbeit macht frei.
Work sets you free, or work makes you free. Anybody know what this dark sardonic statement was in front of Dai?
Auschwitz,
correct.
In Dachau too.
Yeah.
And in Mauthausen?
In Auschwitz, 4 years ago, some Polish workers didn't even really know what it was, what they were looking at. They ripped off the sign to sell the scrap metal. That's what happens when you don't go to school.
It's hard for you guys to understand why people hit, like you said, I learned both sides. Couldn't understand why all these people followed Hitler. When you have nothing, their country had no roads, no economy, no nothing. He came and he gave it all back to them. He built them up. He built them up into a country to be proud of again. And then he started his plan. I find people don't understand why they follow these people. They don't understand why they follow Stalin. They don't. When you have nothing, you will do anything.
Do you guys remember how the one housefrau was heating her house in that white clay oven? What was she burning?
Money.
The blocks of Deutschmark. Do you remember the kids playing with the money with the blocks? Because it was worth?
Nothing. If you have nothing, you will do anything to survive.
Interesting. When we came into Vienna, obviously we were looking to make money, find a job. My mother, who at that time was 35 years old, had lost her husband, became... what was famously known as the brickworks. You go into rooms with a hammer and you clean bricks. 6 days a week, between 60 and 70 hours a week. My mother was making 45 shillings a week. A loaf of bread cost 25 shillings.
so much during the Holocaust and everything. I know a few people that experienced World War II. They went to different countries or different places to start over, but it was kind of hard for them to regain their spots and like stand up again. Did you have that problem too?
No, I was extremely lucky. When I came here, I got a wonderful education, met my wife here, raised my three daughters here. I never wanted to go back. No. And I have not gone back.
Everyone's afraid to ask a question now.
Hey guys, it really is a little tidbit that in Serbia his family's farm still exists. It still exists. Someone must have come along, and when did they start it back up again? Probably
mid-80s.
So 1945, and it only started up in the 1980s. That land existed. His family employed 100 people.
This isn't a small homestead, folks.
No.
If you have 100 people, you're talking something the size of Rego Park.
Mm-hmm.
Working, you know, from sunrise to sundown, 6 days a week. This is a large, large piece of land. Danny again?
The destruction of the farms on, like you said, the 1940s, that people only started up again in the 1980s, that caused because of all the Russians and Serbians taking all of this stuff away from everybody.
Well, if you don't farm a piece of land, it just becomes fallow and nothing happens, you know. And go back and start digging it up again and cleaning it up and the brush it and all that.
A lot of work. I do have a question if no one else has. Maybe, Mr. Stein, you could talk about your memories living in the American Quarter in Vienna, and you had experience with not just American GIs, but you also had Russian soldiers, Soviet soldiers. Do you remember anything about those guys?
I mentioned that to you. What happened is the four nations controlled Vienna. It was deadline, you know, at night. You couldn't go out on the street. Heaven forbid you went on the street. But it was very strictly enforced. And as I mentioned to your teacher that if a soldier misbehaved, be it American or French or English or Russian, they were severely punished. And one experience I've had, I didn't see the actual shooting, but I saw it a minute later. Apparently a Russian soldier accosted a young lady, and the jeep came along. The Russian officer came in, asked some questions, took out his pistol and shot the soldier dead, and he laid there. And nobody was allowed to pick him up. And he lay there for about a day. That's what my grandfather told me. So they were very, very strict. American soldiers, same thing. They were severely disciplined. And that's what occupying force is. The same thing probably happened in Germany. In Berlin, was divided into four. And I read stories about East Berlin. And again, it wasn't so much the Russians, but the East Berliners, which were empowered by the Russians to be in control. So war is not fun when you see stuff like that and hear stuff like this. The other funny things, there was an Austrian who wrote a funny book, because he was a comedian. And I had it, and somehow, I don't know what happened, I lost it. someday maybe I should buy one again if it's still around. You notice some period of after the war happened. Like, for instance, he said you wouldn't dare go out at night. Why? Because heavens forbid you had a nice coat on. Some people would hold you up with a knife and say, give me your coat and I'll dress you and you don't be naked. So you couldn't do anything and you ran away and they robbed you of your coat because it was, you couldn't buy a coat.
I have a cousin who needs those shoes.
Yes.
I have a cousin who needs those pants.
It sounds funny now, but there were some things done. And if it wasn't nailed down, it'd move. When you are in such desperate straits to provide for your family, I think man is almost capable of doing anything. Unfortunately.
Mr. Stein, in 1956, which is when you were 17 years old, and you were told, listen, there's just no future for you here, you know, go to America. What was it like in Vienna in 1956 for you, for your family, or post-war people?
We had a small apartment of about 350 square feet. There was my mother, my sister, and I. No bedroom, it was just a room and a small kitchen, no toilet. Toilet was a common toilet. Apartment house was a walk-up, five stories.
Stairs.
And my grandparents lived in a 220, 230 square foot apartment, same thing. My grandfather worked on the railroad, my mother was still working for a construction company. And my sister had just graduated too. And she wanted to go to the university and we couldn't afford the money. And that's when my grandfather's, unfortunately what happened, he believed in the old Victorian, the son is the most important thing, not the girl. And you need an education. And how do you get education? You go to the United States. He was well read, and he decided that his family's future was in the United States, not in Boston. And when I go back for my class reunion, oh, I absolutely believe I did the right thing. 100%. Oh my God. Because people tend to be lazy and become bureaucrats. And then they retire. In Austria, the retirement age is 58. And the reason it's 58 is because of the younger people get jobs. Okay? Tourism is the big thing. So here are my friends from my age. They retire at 58. So what do they do?
For the last 20 years.
They get up in the morning and have a breakfast. And then between breakfast and lunch, there is what's called Gabelfrühstück, which means a fork breakfast.
I like where this is going.
It might be a sausage.
Go on.
It might be a sausage and a little beer. And then the big lunch. Okay, we go to the sausage stand, see here? Go to the sausage stand. It's interesting.
Yeah, I was
going to
say, don't put
Vienna
sausage in. That's disgusting.
No, but not the Vienna sausage. No, the Vienna sausage stand. Okay, here we go.
This is what my happy place looks like.
See this?
It is so good, guys.
Okay. Guess what? My wife's running eight right there. Okay. So what happened? I took some friends with us. So you go to sausage stand. And by the way, they're open until about 2 o'clock in the morning. So if you go to the theater or a concert and everything else, the tradition is you go there, have a bite to eat, and then you go. Okay. So yeah, and then the
curry works.
The main meal is lunch. It's not dinner. So they eat lunch, which is a 2-hour affair. Go home, take a nap. These are my
friends. Moving to Austria.
Then it's 4 o'clock. Okay. Here come the pastries, coffee and kuchen. Okay. Okay. Since you are put up a konditorei. Vienna konditorei. Now I'll show you some famous ones. Oh, here we go.
You wouldn't be interested in this. Yeah, it's all right. We'll switch.
Okay. So at 4 o'clock, is that? Let me go home.
Oh, now you wake up? Now you're awake?
Let me go home. And then here comes the coup de grace. They go at 7 o'clock. I need my prop, master.
I need your prop.
Oh.
My prop. At 7 o'clock, they go to the Heurigen. H-E-U-R-I-G-E-N.
Thank God for Google Suggest.
Okay.
Oh, I can't wait for November.
Okay, Heurigen. They sit there under the trees in a day close, and they have cold cuts, chicken, and they serve their own wine. They have a law.
This is a hard life.
Okay.
And their beer, dear.
And beer, they drink. And then they go home at 10 o'clock, and then you wonder, when you see them, and there's a picture of me, when I first met my wife, again, she said, they look 20 years older than you are. Well, they're like this, they're bloated.
What are you trying to say?
No reference to the local.
There's a lot of salad.
They look old, because they eat too much. And most of it, unfortunately, is pork products and various things, because beef tends to be expensive. No, but Vienna was considered recently in a poll as number one, number two city of the best lived or the most desirable city to live in. And there's no question. I mean, they have a way of life which is much slower than here. They have less entrepreneurial spirit at all. And look, you know, you can always go back, you can do the same thing here. But you choose your lifestyle. But I wouldn't advise you, when you have money on your own feet.
We only have a small number of minutes left, so you know, if you have questions, you don't have all day.
How do you think your life would have been if you stayed here?
I would have probably worked for the post office or the official train, Österreichische Bundesbahn, because everybody worked for, this is where you, or for a bank, okay? And it's a job, and what happens over there, they have a system, which comes back from the 18th, 19th century, they have a system to make your job more important. I give you an example. You're a conductor on a streetcar, okay? And then you get promoted to, you said conductor, over conductor. And then you get promoted again. Then you're a sheetmeister. And as you get promoted, and they know it, every 5-6 years you get promoted, and it's by name only, but it's important. And you get a uniform, and you get some cluster and all that. So all of a sudden, you're very important. As you walk down the street, and your neighbor sees and says, oh, look at him, he became over for Schulmeister. But he's doing the same job he did when he started out, okay? It's a way, yeah, it's a way of the way the Austro-Hungarian Empire,
title
was everything. I give an example. I mean, first time I went back to Vienna, and my grandmother said to me, my grandfather, go buy some stuff to the grocery, there's a little grocery store. And so we went to the grocery store, and they open up at 4 o'clock. They close between 12 and 4, still do today. So we went there, and there was a line outside, and the store is very small. There was about 4 or 5 people inside. So as we get in, the proprietor says to him, oh, Mr. Stein, how are you? Good to see you. I'm Geert Zienen, you know, and Chris Crooks and various things. And then he said, but who is that young man with you? And my grandfather sort of pricked his heels and said, may I have the pleasure to introduce my grandson? He's from America. He's an architect. Well, right away, the people in front of us stepped aside, And prior to this time, please come first in line. And they addressed me as Dr. Professor Stein. Okay, title. Everything was title. The worst thing was they addressed my wife then as Mrs. Frau Professor, Frau Doctor, which means Stein. And my wife was
Mrs.
Frau is a Mrs. Frau is a Mrs. You're Mrs. Professor, Mrs. Dr. Stein. And my wife, being the American she is, she says, I'm not a professor, and I'm not a Stein, and they were aghast. It's, you know, every nation has its traditions, and Austria tends to be a little bit backward, not backward, based on what they call the Kaiserthal.
We're going to take one or two last questions, and then if you guys would like, we can take a class photo with Mr. Stein. Juan?
Are you still fond of soccer?
Don't go there.
Fond of soccer.
Tell him what you achieved a couple years back.
It's hard to talk about your own achievement. Matter of fact, I'll tell you a story. My wife and I, we are.
I'll do it.
I'll do it. Or may I tell the story?
This is amazing. This is.
We were at a fair at University of Pennsylvania. My husband.
100-year
anniversary.
Penn soccer.
From Penn soccer. Not that I thought it was 100, but, you know, he was there. And they were talking about all the things that went on with soccer. Scholarships and trips, and all of a sudden they mentioned my husband, Hans Stein, was asked to go to the Olympics because he was such a good soccer person. I had no idea because he doesn't talk about wonderful things like that.
What year, 1960?
64. And I said to him, why didn't you go? An opportunity to be in the Olympics? And you replied,
I was just married. And I had a baby, and I was supposed to go to the camp, which was in San Francisco, and they made $3,000. Ask me how much money I made a year, that year, $4,000. Okay, I couldn't afford it. Those days, it was economic, amateurism. I couldn't get any help. But I loved soccer, still follow it. As a matter of fact, I have 2 full-time channels. That's my wife. Okay, I just watched Barcelona trash coffee last night. Okay? But now I.
Well, you've heard of Barcelona. Okay.
So, no, but my biggest honor was maybe the Olympics I was asked, but my biggest honor was in that affair, my wife mentioned, they selected the 100-year team. And I happened to be one of the 15 people selected.
Yep.
So I had a wonderful time at Penn.
Team of the century, guys.
Team of the century at Penn.
With him.
And
your coach was still alive.
Did that answer your question a little bit?
He was good.
What position did you play?
Midfield. Well, the old days were called left half. Now it's called midfield.
I could run like that.
My soccer coach in Penn just died at age 99 last year.
All right, folks, we have to do this movie because there's going to be a class coming in.